Where do today's popular religious holidays come from? What are their roots? Most people never reflect on or investigate why they believe and practice what they do. In a world filled with customs and traditions, few research and seek to understand the origin of things. Almost everyone accepts common practices without question, choosing to do what everyone else does because it is easy and fashionable. Most follow along as they have been taught, assuming what they believe and do is right. They take their beliefs for granted and never take time to prove them. Nowhere is this more true than in the observance of Easter, Christmas, New Year's, Halloween, and Valentine's Day, among other supposed Christian holidays. Billions keep these days without knowing why or where they originated. Most suppose they are found in the Bible, that God backs them because they see so many professing Christians observing them. Surely billions cannot be wrong, or can they? What do the Bible and history really teach? You will be shocked.
The World to Come. The Restored Church of God presents David C. Pack, author of 80 books and booklets, editor-in-chief of The Real Truth magazine, read by countless and growing numbers in every nation and territory of the world. In a violent age, full of bad news, answering life's greatest questions straight from the Bible and announcing the wonderful good news of the world to come. And now, David C. Pack.
To find the truth of a biblical matter, any biblical matter, you must be willing to open your Bible and honestly accept what it says. The majority of people stoutly defend what they have merely assumed is right or biblical. They read with prejudice anything that contradicts cherished beliefs. If you're going to take the time to view this broadcast, should you not at least watch it with an open mind, without bias? The Bible is profitable for correction, it says, for those willing to accept it, for all who truly want to serve and please God. It also states, prove all things. Ask God to guide you, to help you prove what He says in His Word. No matter how comfortable a lifelong practice may be, should you not base it on proof, hard evidence, and on what God says instead of assumptions? In this broadcast, we will examine certain of men's holidays and their origins. What follows is but the barest beginning of all that could be shown. First is Easter. What does history record about the origin of Easter? The vast majority of ecclesiastical and secular historians agree that the name of Easter and the traditions surrounding it are deeply rooted in pagan religion. Powerful quotes demonstrate the true origin of how the modern Easter celebration got its name. First is this admission. Since Bede the Venerable, the origin of the term for the Feast of Christ's Resurrection has been popularly considered to be from the Anglo-Saxon Easter, a goddess of spring. Also, the name comes from the Old High German plural for dawn, Osterun, whence has come the German Ostern and our English Easter. Now, a second quote. The fact that vernal festivals were general among pagan peoples no doubt had much to do with the form assumed by the Easter festival in the Christian churches. The English term Easter is of pagan origin. Now, a third. The name Easter comes to us from Ostera, or Easter, the Anglo-Saxon goddess of spring, for whom a spring festival was held annually, and it is from this pagan festival that some of our Easter customs have come. What about eggs? These have always been linked to the Easter celebration. Nearly every culture in today's world has a long tradition of coloring eggs. Notice this. The origin of the Easter egg is based on the fertility lore of the Indo-European races. The egg to them was a symbol of spring. In Christian times, the egg had bestowed upon it a religious interpretation, becoming a symbol of the rock tomb out of which Christ emerged to the new life of His resurrection. Think. The all-powerful Jesus Christ is reduced to being an egg just so people can hold to a pagan custom. Incredible. Let's see where the Easter Bunny came from. In Germany and Austria, little nests containing eggs, pastry, and candy are placed in hidden spots, and the children believe that the Easter Bunny laid the eggs and brought the candy. The Easter Bunny had its origin in pre-Christian fertility lore. It has never had religious symbolism bestowed on its festive usage. There is nothing Christian about either of these symbols. The true history of what are fertility symbols, rabbits and eggs, are unknown to children who will believe whatever someone tells them. These are outright lies foisted on innocent little victims who have no means of resisting such indoctrination. Now, sunrise services are mentioned in the Bible, but not in a way you expect. The context is the prophet Ezekiel being shown in vision an important prophecy concerning the sins of God's people in our time. These astonishing verses reveal God's plain condemnation of sunrise services and what will happen to those who dismiss or minimize his command. "Turn you yet again," Ezekiel writes, "and you shall see greater abominations that they do. And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house. And behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men, with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east. And they worshiped the sun toward the east. Then God said to me, 'Have you seen this? Is it a light thing or is it no big deal that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have returned to provoke me to anger. Therefore, while I also deal in fury, my eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity.'" Observing sunrise services is serious to God. He so hates this vile practice that he will ultimately destroy all who persist in what he calls abomination. What about hot cross buns? The prophet Jeremiah wrote this: "The children gather wood, and the fathers kindle the fire, and the women knead their dough to make cakes to the Queen of Heaven, and to pour out drink offerings to other gods, that they may provoke me to anger." These cakes were the same hot cross buns that millions of children sing about today. The famous historian Will Durant wrote, "Ishtar, pronounced Easter, interests us not only as analog of the Egyptian Isis and prototype of the Grecian Aphrodite and the Roman Venus, but as the formal beneficiary of one of the strangest of Babylonian customs, known to us chiefly from a famous page in Herodotus, which is, every native woman is obliged, once in her life, to sit in the temple of Venus, Easter, and have intercourse with some stranger." We now know Easter is the goddess Ashtaroth. Now we need to examine the Bible for what God thinks of her. Notice this: "And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtaroth," again, Easter. The prophet Samuel warned Israel to "put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord and serve him only." Then the children of Israel did put away Baalim and Ashtaroth and served the Lord only. Later, Samuel reminded Israel of its history, that they would return to obey God only to fall back into idolatry time and again. We have seen that God never instructed, but rather actually commanded against Easter observance. What seems so innocent is not innocent at all. Much additional proof, biblical and historical, exists proving Easter is not permitted by God. These publications, The True Origin of Easter and Christ's Resurrection Was Not on Sunday, are must-reads for those who really want to understand the evil of Easter from God's perspective. Next is Christmas. This worldwide tradition is thought to be a wonderful time focused on giving, family, beautiful music and decorations, special foods, and singing traditional carols. All this is supposedly centered around the worship of Jesus Christ and his birth on December 25th. But where did Christmas come from? What is the origin of Santa Claus? Mistletoe. Christmas trees, holly wreaths, Yule logs, and exchanging gifts. There is no mistaking the source of the modern Christmas celebration. Nearly all aspects of it have their roots in Roman custom and religion. The Encyclopedia Americana reveals Christmas was not observed in the first centuries of the Christian church, since the Christian usage in general was to celebrate the death of remarkable persons rather than their birth. A feast was established in memory of this event, Christ's birth, in the 4th century. In the 5th century, the Western Church ordered the feast to be celebrated on the day of the Mithraic rites of the birth of the sun, and at the close of the Saturnalia, as no certain knowledge of the day of Christ's birth existed. Now the Encyclopedia Britannica under Christmas. In the Roman world, the Saturnalia, December 17th, was a time of merrymaking and exchanging of gifts. December 25th was also regarded as the birth date of the Iranian mystery god Mithra, the sun, S-U-N, of righteousness. On the Roman New Year, January 1st, houses were decorated with greenery and lights, and gifts were given to children and the poor. To these observances were added the German and Celtic Yule rites when the Teutonic tribes penetrated into Gaul, Britain, and Central Europe. Food and good fellowship, the Yule log and Yule cakes, greenery and fir trees, gifts and greetings, all commemorated different aspects of this festive season. Fires and lights, symbols of warmth and lasting life, have always been associated with the winter festival, both pagan and Christian, or supposedly Christian, I would add. These statements are plain. Most aspects of Christmas are not mentioned in the Bible. The reason is that they are not from God. They are not part of the way He wants people to worship Him. The Christmas tree, however, is mentioned in God's Word. We know what men think about it. Here is what God says. Thus says the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, or the stars, for the heathen are dismayed at them. We might ask at this point, why do millions ignore this plain statement of God and read their horoscopes every day? Continuing, for the customs of the people are vain. For one cuts a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen, with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. They are upright as the palm tree. This description is obvious. God directly refers to the Christmas tree as the way of the heathen. Just as directly, He commands, learn not the way of the heathen, calling these customs vain. Many additional sources and scriptures could be cited. Our thorough booklet, The True Origin of Christmas, brings facts from history and scripture that, when placed together, paint a powerful picture. Next, let's examine Valentine's Day, known as the world's holiday of love. Surely, celebrating a festive holiday like Valentine's Day is harmless. Surely, the God who gives us life, food, drink, and the ability to think for ourselves approves of the holiday for lovers to exchange gifts. Let's see. Innocent and harmless as Valentine's may appear, its traditions and customs originate from two of the most sexually perverted pagan festivals of ancient history, the Lupercalia and the feast day of Juno Februata. To the Romans, February was sacred to Juno Februata, the goddess of febris, or fever, of love, and of women in marriage. On February 14th, billets, small pieces of paper with the name of a teenaged girl written on it, were put into a container. Boys would then choose one billet at random. The boy and the girl whose name was drawn would become a couple, joining in erotic games at feasts and parties celebrated throughout Rome. After the festival, they would remain sexual partners throughout that year. This custom was observed in the Roman Empire for centuries. Valentine's Day is designed to appeal to carnal desires, or, as the Bible calls them, the works of the flesh. Read Galatians 5. Verses 19 to 21. Christmas, Easter, and Valentine's are all attempts to whitewash customs and observances of pagan gods and idols by Christianizing them, meaning pasting Christian-sounding names over them.
The world to come will continue. In addition to the literature ordered with this program, you will receive a free one-year subscription to The Real Truth. This magazine answers the question, why so much bad news in today's headlines? It explains the root causes behind the bad effects and points to the good news of the only possible solution, the soon coming kingdom of God. Your subscription is free with any literature order.
What about New Year's? What could be wrong with celebrating the start of the upcoming year? What's wrong with ringing out the old and ringing in the new? The truth is surprising. The Bible reveals God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. The Greek word for confusion also means instability, disorder, commotion, and tumult, words that perfectly describe New Year's history, which is as confusing and chaotic as the holiday itself. For thousands of years, men kept changing the beginning of their New Year from spring to fall, from March 1st to January 1st. And in some cases, December 25th, back to March 25th, then to January 1st again. Notice, January 1st was restored as New Year's Day by the Gregorian calendar, AD 1582, immediately adopted by Roman Catholic countries. Other countries slowly followed suit. Scotland, 1660, Germany and Denmark, about 1700, England, 1752, Sweden, 1753, and Russia, 1918. Even today, however, nations cannot agree on this date. The Chinese New Year is celebrated officially for a month, beginning in late January or early February, and the Muslim New Year falls on the first day of the month of Muharram and commemorates the date of the Hajira, July 16th, 622, on the Gregorian calendar. Since the Muslim year is a lunar one consisting of only 354 days, the commencement of the new year fluctuates widely by the Western calendar. The God of the Bible said this to ancient Israel about the false gods they would encounter in the land he gave them. You shall not bow down to their gods, nor serve them, nor do after their works, lest they make you sin against me. Their gods will surely be a snare unto you. This certainly pictures New Year's and other holidays we have seen. Nowhere does God in His Word command New Year's celebration. Then there is Halloween. Americans spend $4 to $5 billion every year on this second largest holiday besides Christmas. Is this just a harmless, happy childhood activity or something very different? Its traditions, customs, and practices are rooted in a past much darker, more sinister, and more demonic than you know. On the night of October 31st, the ancient Celts, or Celts, after harvesting and storing their crops for the winter, began their annual fall festival. The Encyclopedia Britannica reveals Samhain, Celtic for end of summer, often pronounced Samhain, one of the most important and sinister calendar festivals of the Celtic year. At Samhain, held on November 1st, the world of the gods was believed to be made visible to mankind, and the gods played many tricks on their mortal worshippers. It was a time fraught with danger, charged with fear, and full of supernatural episodes. Sacrifices and propitiations of every kind were thought to be vital, for without them, the Celts believed they could not prevail over the perils of the season or counteract the activities of the deities. Samhain was an important precursor to Halloween. The Celts observed the festival of Samhain in various forms. The Catholic Church took note. Throughout that church's early history, worshippers observed special anniversaries for martyrs who had been executed for their beliefs. Soon there were not enough days in the calendar year to dedicate a specific day for each martyr. So the Roman Catholic Church chose one feast day, All Saints' Day, for its martyrs. In the early 9th century, Pope Gregory IV sought to paste over this pagan practice by moving so-called All Saints Day from May 13th to November 1st, the same day as Samhain. This officially extended this pagan festival to that entire church. Later, All Saints Day became known as All Hallows Day, while October 31st became All Hallows Eve. You know this carefully chosen heathen practice as Halloween. Now for birthday celebrations. In every culture and nation on earth, nothing is as universally celebrated. But is this practice biblical? Does God agree with it? Wise King Solomon wrote, "Better is the day of death than the day of one's birth." We would all agree that the day of one's death is not exactly his best day. Yet God says it's better than the day of his birth. Here is the briefest look at the history of birthday celebrations. The Greeks believed that everyone had a protective spirit or demon who attended his birth and watched over him in life. This spirit or demon had a mystic relation with the god on whose birthday the individual was born. This source continues, the Romans also subscribed to this idea. This notion was carried down in human belief and is reflected in the guardian angel, the fairy godmother, and the patron saint. The custom of lighted candles on the cake started with the Greeks. Honey cakes round as the moon and lit with tapers were placed on the temple altars of the goddess Artemis. Birthday candles, in folk belief, are endowed with special magic for granting wishes. Lighted tapers and sacrificial fires have had a special mystic significance ever since man first set up altars to his gods. The birthday candles are thus an honor and tribute to the birthday child and bring good fortune. Birthday celebrations are mentioned in the Bible on three separate occasions, and in each, terrible things occurred. Our article, "Are Birthday Celebrations Christian?" presents more of the truth about birthday keeping. What about April Fool's Day, also known as All Fool's Day? Every April 1st, millions participate in pranks, practical jokes, and even outright lies in the name of innocent fun. Our article, "A Foolish Holiday," reveals the origin of this day and whether one should observe it. Finally, you may now be wondering about Thanksgiving Day. In fact, this is one of the few holidays not steeped in pagan tradition. Thanksgiving is set aside to show appreciation to Almighty God for the many blessings America has received, but is today so tragically forgotten. Here is another article you may wish to read, "Should You Celebrate Thanksgiving Day?" Men want to observe their own holidays in place of God's seven annual holy days, outlined and commanded in His Word, and then tell themselves they are pleasing and worshiping the true God. Jesus warned, "In vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." And he added in Mark's account, "Full well, or knowing full well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition." Every year, around the world, 2 billion professing Christians do reject God's word and keep men's holidays. No wonder Jesus asked, "Why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" God told Israel, "You shall not walk in the manners of the nations which I cast out before you, for they committed all these things, and therefore I abhorred them, and you shall be holy unto me. For I, the Lord, am holy, and have severed you from other people, that you should be mine." God commands His followers to come out of the world and its Babylonish ways. Notice, "Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and receive not of her plagues." Worldwide disobedience comes with a terrible price. National punishment now lies just ahead for the world's greatest nations, the ones who have been custodians of the Bible and who should and could have known the truth you now know. In the second commandment, forbidding all forms of idolatry, and in other passages, God declares He is a jealous God. He wants His people doing what He commands, not the practices of false gods. we saw God plainly instructs, learn not the way of the heathen. But most people do not fear God. They do not care what he says, and he allows them to make their own decisions. Human beings are free moral agents, free to learn or not learn what God commands, free to obey or disobey him. But woe to those who ignore the plain word of the Bible, believing men can overrule God. People can worship in ways that represent things far different from what they sincerely believe or intend. When they have observed a custom for a long time, they come to identify with it as though it were their own. They vest in it. When one tries to tell them the truth, presenting facts, evidence, and proof, many become hostile, angry that one would dare violate sacred personal beliefs. The proof is overwhelming that men's holidays are human traditions, commandments of men, condemned by God. Yet the masses keep them anyway. God makes absolutely clear he does not want us to mix his ways with any false ways. He says, "What things soever I command you, observe to do it. You shall not add thereto, nor diminish from it." In other words, do exactly what I say, nothing more, nothing less. Be careful of being angry that I am taking away your holidays. Your anger is in fact directed at God. I merely told you what he says. Direct your anger at the ministers you trusted, but who knew better and deceived you. So then, am I bad-mouthing cherished holidays or reporting the truth? Don't shoot the messenger. The message comes from God. The literature offered throughout this broadcast are all must-reads for those who care what God thinks about days that men think so special. God declares in multiple places and in words impossible to misunderstand for those seeking his correction that he hates the customs associated with pagan celebrations. And we saw his plain words to all who say they can mix the horrible customs of outright paganism with a supposed focus on Jesus. To learn about God's holy days, read this booklet, God's Holy Days or Pagan Holidays. You will be glad you did. You face a choice. Listen to confused, deceived ministers and follow the masses and their traditions, or open your mind and your Bible, listen to God, and seek the truth. Until next time, this is David C. Pack saying goodbye, friends.
This program was made available by Restored Church of God members and donors from around the globe. Explore our vast library of literature and other World to Come programs, which are all made available free of charge. To order literature featured in this program, call toll-free 1-855-828-4646. That number again, 1-855-828-4646.